We might ask ourselves, when we give thanks, what are we doing? You see, it's taken for granted that gratitude is what this day is all about. But if gratitude begins and ends with a feeling and nothing more, then my friends, Thanksgiving will be pointless. I'll say that again. If our gratitude begins and ends with a warm, fuzzy feeling full of turkey and tryptophan, then today will have been pointless. In today's gospel lesson, there are 10 lepers crying out to Jesus Christ, "Master, have mercy on us." And he does. He heals them. But perhaps we don't realize what that means for them. You see, in this time, in the first century, as a Jew, plus one Samaritan, to have leprosy meant to be completely cut off from community, completely cut off from everyone and everything we know. Today, when we celebrate family, today when we celebrate community, today when we come together to worship God, we encounter 10 people who have been cut off, perhaps for years, from every vestige of community, from worship, from contact, physical contact and nearness of another person. Christ encounters them, and they are changed. And that reality, that for them had been isolation and loneliness and suffering, became a doorway into communion and joy and life. And so we usually think of the 9 as being ungrateful. I doubt it. I suspect they were incredibly happy, perhaps thankful that they were healed. This was a life-changing circumstance. But their gratitude began and ended with a feeling. For one, however, gratitude was a vehicle to do something. And he did the best thing he possibly could. He came back to Christ. He fell down before him, and he thanked him. And Christ's response, he's somewhat disappointed. "We're not the rescue. You're a foreigner. You've come to thank me. Where are my people? Where are my people who are called to constant praise and thanksgiving of God? They have been healed, and they could not come back to worship me." You see, gratitude as action, gratitude as giving glory to God, runs throughout the whole history of salvation. In the Old Testament, we see the offerings that are given by Abel, by Noah, by Abraham. We see the offerings that are given in the temples. We see constant offering and glorification of God as a response to his manifold blessings. There is always action that results in a feeling of gratitude. During his earthly ministry, there was never a dinner time that our Lord did not give thanks to his Father for what had been given. And he gave thanks also for his disciples. He gave thanks for the road that was set for him so that he could redeem humanity. The Son and God gave thanks constantly to the Father in action. But then he ascended the cross, and his gratitude We like to take beautiful things, and we like to think about them, but it is difficult to act on them. When we think of love, culturally, what we are given is a warm and a fuzzy feeling, and it ends there, our understanding of love. And when we think of gratitude, we think of manifesting feelings of happiness and cheer. And when we think of repentance, we think of being sorry. But we don't think of love and gratitude and repentance in this culture as each one of these calling us to completely and radically change our way of life. Today we are here, and so I don't have to tell you about the importance and the primacy of worship in our life of Thanksgiving, because it's Thanksgiving Day and we're all here. But let us think about what it means to be here. You see, in just a little while, we will be taking that which God Himself gave to us in the elements of bread and of wine. We will give them back, saying, "Thine own of thine own." And as we offer it up to God, we offer it for all of creation. We offer to you on behalf of all and for all. And we ask Him to fill us and our offering, saying, "Send now your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts here presented." And this Eucharistic pattern is a pattern for the whole of our Christian life as we respond out of gratitude. Because Eucharist means nothing other than to give thanks. And our whole Christian life is patterned on this giving thanks that we participate in this morning. What do I mean? If we understand that our very existence, our being, is a gift, that our continued life is dependent on the mercy and the power and the grace of God. If we understand that our salvation, the very possibility to have access to God, to have communion with Him in love and with His saints, if we understand those things to be gift, then we understand that our whole life, not just the bread and the wine that we offer today, but our whole life has been presented to us so that we would take it and give it back to God to be transformed, to be sanctified, so that it would be given over for the sake of the whole world. We see in the Eucharist the reality, the fundamental reality of the whole calling of Christian existence. Today, on this day of Thanksgiving, as we ponder those wonderful, rich blessings, it must not stop with a feeling. It must become a Eucharistic offering, an offering of all of ourselves to God, so that He would bless it and change it and distribute it to all. It's easy during this holiday season to think about how we do that. It's very common to go to a soup kitchen once during the holidays. It's very easy to give something now. The difficulty will come after the new year, when we are out of this period, this season, where we're reminded of all of these things. The difficulty comes in sustaining an effort in order to take that grace and that self-offering that we have from Christ on the cross, and to offer ourselves in the same way, not only during the holidays, but always, so that our whole life can become a self-offering in response to the Father's gift. We go to our Thanksgiving tables, heavy laden for the feast. But we remember this table, the sacred altar, which presents to us the Eucharist, the Thanksgiving feast that has been laid by the Father Himself for His children. life where all we are and all we have is offered up to God in gratitude, to be transformed by His grace for the salvation of the whole world.